that. So then this is that hi-hat type of beat. Isn't that how it goes? Something like that. welcome to worship this morning here at King's Way. Glad to have you all here this morning. I invite you to stand as you're able and join us in singing on this first song, God So Loved.
We celebrate today as we prepare to share in communion together the table where we remember that Jesus offered himself for us. My name is Pastor Karen Hayden, and we are so glad that you are here with us today. Obviously, we are celebrating our children and the wonderful things that happened in Summer Jam, which ended in summer camp this past week. But a couple of other things I want to share with you. As you came in, or if you are online, you may have seen our Connect cards. online. We invite you to connect with us and register your attendance and any prayer concerns that you might have or updated information. Those of you in person can use a Connect card to do that and return it in the offering plate in a few moments as they are passed. In your bulletin today or online, you can find information about some of our upcoming events. I want to highlight a pop-up book club that ends our summer pop-up books club studies, August 18th or 19th. Pick your time or come to both if you want, but it's the same book. And we are reading The Wisdom Chaser by Nathan Foster. He is the son of Richard Foster, which the Wednesday night group has been doing a study of his, so it's nice to see them come together. We are doing a school supply drive as the start of school is almost here. And so we have been collecting new back-to-school supplies, and we'll share them with different persons and agencies in our community. And you can return those to on Sunday mornings to the bins located in the door in the south lobby or in the children's wing. You can bring them by during the week from Monday through Friday from 8 to 4. And if you have any questions about our school supply drive or other ways to help, please call the church office. Speaking of, our office and building will be closed on Thursday from 8 to 2 as our whole staff is out for a retreat. Pray for us in our time of fun and community building. Again, August 11th from 8 to 2. Next Sunday, we continue with our Resilient Faith series, and at the 9:15 hour, we are inviting all parents, grandparents, guardians raising children for a 50-minute training called Nurturing Qualities of Healthy, Strong Families. And this opportunity is taught by Dr. Jim Meyer, held at 9:15 next Sunday in the chapel. Finally, I lift up a renewed opportunity. It's been a little while since there has been a women's retreat at Kingsway, and September 16th and 17th. We will host one here for all women of Kingsway and other women friends, but it'll be the evening of September 16th and the day of the 17th. With all of these things, we remember the gifts that we have been given and celebrate all that has happened this summer with our children's ministry. Last Sunday, I stood up and said, sometimes I get specific in my asks, and I called on you to help with our children's ministry this past week. You came through in your time and your presence. And at the close of the service, we'll celebrate with a video or a slideshow of that. But right now, our children are going to come and sing as we receive the offering together. We give thanks for all the ways that they have learned this week, that they are participants in God's world, make waves together, and the things that they learned through song and service and community building together. And yes, we had some fun too. thank you for that celebration of our children. And children, thank you for the reminder of love that we are to offer in the world as we receive back our offerings now. For all that God has given us, we're reminded of our partnership and relationship with God in this world, and that was a big part of what we talked about in Making Waves this week. Some of you may remember that it was just a couple months ago that all of our plans changed for the summer day camp that we were going to have. And I lift up the resiliency of our staff and volunteer staff to make what happened happen. Especially want to lift up Miss Lakin and the work that she did and the coordinating of all things that happened. And it reminds me of the different ways, yes, that we are all called to serve. And as I look out on you, I remember last week I called for more volunteers. There were people who helped serve food and prayed for us, offered resources, and stood and danced with the children and led them through the room. And I give thanks for that. Today, I also want to lift up two individuals who know something about resiliency. Two people that interned with us in the summer of 2020. Think about that for just a minute. Wesley Spargo and Kelsey Mitchell joined with us that summer as they were candidates in ministry, and now in summer of 22 are preparing to go to seminary. Wesley to Atlanta, Kelsey to St. Louis, and I want us to remember beginning today the journey that they have to seminary. It's a three-ish long year journey, and we want to pray for them, the communities that they'll be a part of, and the work that they do. As we remember them, we remember a saint in our community, Fred Royer, who passed away this week. and his ministry through the years with Karen that have touched so many lives. His service celebration of life will be held Saturday here at Kingsway. You can find out more information on Greenlawn's website. I want to give thanks for his life and ministry and teachings as we all come together this day to share our concerns and joys together. May we pray. Loving God, sometimes we fill our journals of gratitude, and that seems easy to do. Sometimes it feels like we've got to search for the things that we are grateful for because we have lots of questions or may be standing on shaky ground. And so we give thanks for a community of faith that is resilient and works together and has a good time as they teach and share with children in our own church and throughout the community. We give thanks for you, God, and the love that you pour out to us, the ways that we see it and the ways where it is unseen, as we bring our joys and concerns together this day. We celebrate those in set-aside ministry. We celebrate those that have finished their course faithfully. We are expectant for the ways in which you will show up in our life and our time today. We thank you for the words that Pastor Scott has prepared and the ways in which he will remind us of your words on resiliency. Thank you, God. Thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Hi, my name is Daniel Barclay, and I'm the worship media coordinator here at Kingsway. And I was hired back in 2020. So I've been here for about 2 years. We're approaching that pretty soon, I think.
Hi, I'm Caitlin Palmer. I have been a congregate at Kingsway for 18 years.
A song that encourages me in my faith is Cornerstone. It brings me back to this kind of Christian program I did when I was a junior in high school. This program was a month long, and it consisted of 10 days, split it up into 3 10-day days of different elements. And some of those were studying in a seminary, others were going to Nicaragua and serving. But the song Cornerstone happened when I was in Nicaragua, where it was just beautiful. So many people, so spiritual, so genuine. And every time I hear the song, it just brings me back to that moment and kind of relive it again. And that's something that's really exciting for me. What moves me out of adversity, really, is talking to others, Christian, non-Christian. I really love having deep, meaningful conversations with people. A lot of them oftentimes are Christian related, religious related. And when I'm struggling, when I'm having a difficult time, by talking to someone else, I can let it all out, process it better for myself, as well as discuss it with someone. And we'll just, even if they don't have anything advice-wise, even if they're just inclined, even if they just feel like they understand me, is so much comfort to me, and it helps me overcome whatever difficulty I'm facing. So really just talking to people is one of the biggest things for me.
For me, being in the worship team, I have a lot of favorite songs that I listen to all the time, but I think one that really sticks with me is Highs and Lows by Hillsong. And my favorite part of it is just highs and lows, you're with me wherever I go. And it's basically so saying, even though I may fail, you're still going to be with me. And I think that just points to his everlasting and reckless love. Like, I've done nothing to deserve it. And then I think that goes into what takes me out of adversity is, you know, I've done nothing to earn what God's given me. I'm a sinner. I'm flawed. I'm so imperfect. But I use that brokenness to grow and let that light shine through me. And knowing that I have someone who's with me, no matter what mistake I make, no matter how imperfect I am, makes going through a struggle a lot easier.
You are faithful through it all. of your grace I know. Should I rise or should I fall? You are faithful through it all. You're too good to let me go.
Good morning. I teased the first service. I'll let you guys off easy. You guys should be more caffeinated. You got a little bit more sleep, but it's good to see you. It's good to be back from vacation. If you don't know who I am and why I'm saying that, my name is Pastor Scott Bonds. I'm the associate pastor here at Kingsway. And I'm good. It is good to be back from vacation, even though I didn't go anywhere. But it's also good to be back because we're in this series called Resilient Faith. And over the last few weeks, we've looked at different aspects of resilient faith, the obstacles to it, as well as how do we get it. And we've been guided on our journey by a couple of things, a working definition along with a reoccurring theme. Now, before I get to those couple of things, to make sure we're all on the same page, I want to encourage you, if you've not been a part of this series and you're curious about some of the things that we talked about, I want to encourage you to go online and you can find on Vimeo our whole catalog of every sermon that we've posted on there. But you can find our Resilient Faith series and kind of catch along with the series. But with that, our working definition of resilient faith has been this. Resilient faith is a quality of faith that's able to see us through trouble, temptation, and trials, and even come through stronger. And we've been looking at it through the lens of Romans 5, 3 through 5. And if you've got your Bibles, I encourage you to go ahead and open them up to them. There's a Pew Bible in front of you. If you've got a phone app, whatever. If not, don't worry. It is going to be on the screen. I'm going to be reading through the ESV version. Romans 5, 3 through 5 says this. Not only that, but we rejoice in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. Resilient faith. In the church and research world, the team at Barna has been considering this issue since 2011, and especially since 2019, when they published their research on resilient faith. It's a topic that medical professionals and mental health professionals have been studying, something that I've been considering since seminary. And in there, they published all of this work in a book called Faith for Exiles. And if anything that we say throughout this series interests you at all, I would encourage you to pick that book up and give it a good read. But what I love about Barna is they published all of the statistics that I've shared with you over time about how many young people are leaving the church and abandoning the faith, but they didn't just stop there. They didn't just look at the problem, but they also tried to find the positives. Barna and David Kinneman in particular, they've looked at all of this, and they've researched the small but significant number of young adults who kind of buck this trend of abandoning the faith and walking away from the church. And they called them resilient disciples, right? And in their research, they found five common principles or practices of these resilient disciples. So these five common things are things that they had that were meaningful and significant. First is vocational discipleship, this idea that their careers and their professions they're formed and shaped and make a difference, more than just being a pastor or a missionary. They had meaningful relationships, intergenerational relationships with other people. They learned about and experienced countercultural mission, about being different, and that their faith led to making a difference in the world. They had cultural discernment in common, and the idea of understanding what is of God and what is of the culture and how to navigate all of those kind of things. But most importantly, I think, the thing that they had in common was experiencing Jesus. Experiencing Jesus, not just having a faith or going to church, but they, in their experiences, they had actually experienced Jesus. Those they called resilient disciples described their faith like this. They said, worship isn't a lifestyle, or it is a lifestyle. It's not just an event. It's not just something I go to. It's something I do 24/7, 365. They said that Jesus had deeply transformed their life, changed their life. That reading the Bible makes them feel closer to God. That Jesus understands what their life is like these days. They shared that the regular experience at church is to know the reality of God's presence. So not just come to church, but they experience God's presence while here. They receive guidance on how to grow in the fruits of the Spirit: love, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, self-control. They were re-energized when they spent time with Jesus. Jesus speaks to them in ways that is relevant to their lives. That listening to God is a big part of their prayer life, and that prayer does not seem like a formal routine, but a vibrant part of their life. That's how they describe their faith, these resilient disciples. Now, I shared a few weeks back in a sermon called Follow Me, one of the ways that we can hear from God, how we can experience God, how we can know God, how we can hear that He's saying something to us is through circumstances and events. It's not just prayer, not just reading the Bible, right? Not just some inner voice, but through the things that happen in us and around us in our lives and in the world, through circumstances and situations. And I think this, in some ways, is what Paul is trying to get in our verse this morning. Paul is a man who knew a lot of suffering. He knew a lot of trials. He knew what a difficult life was like. And he had to deal with all of these situations and circumstances, and he wrote a lot about them in his writings. But he says these situations and circumstances that we deal with produce good things in us. He says these sufferings and these trials, they produce endurance. And that endurance builds character, and character, hope. Now, I don't know about you, but I want hope. I like hope. Amen? You want hope, right? You want to be hopeful, or do you like, you know, being pessimistic and negative and like, you know, everybody loves Eeyore at the party, right? Some do. But no, we all want a little bit of hope. And the thing that I love is sometimes we can feel like the writers, it's just this lofty idea that they write about. But these ideas of Paul would eventually be put to the test. In about 3 short years after he wrote these things in Romans, Paul would eventually go to Rome and to the church in which he wrote to, right? He would eventually be arrested and would pretty much spend the rest of his life and ministry in prison before he would eventually die for his faith. And Paul, in these prison writings, would go on to speak even more boldly and practical about issues that affect Christians, like the power of forgiveness and the impact of grace on our lives. And Paul's prison letters also confirm that a Christian's place in the kingdom of God, in God's kingdom, is not determined by their physical circumstances. Let me say that again, because I don't want you to miss it. Paul would write that a Christian's place in the kingdom of God is not determined by their physical circumstances. And friends, that can be hard to hear. That can be hard to hear. Why? Because sometimes we don't like adverse physical circumstances, do we? We'll go to great lengths to protect and distance ourselves from pain and from suffering and hardship. We'll do everything we can to avoid it. Because we directly connect struggles and hardships and pain and suffering with a lack of God's presence or His punishment or His judgment on us. That if we're going through some things, God is obviously against us or He's mad at us. And so it's hard to hear that these physical circumstances don't affect our relationship with God and our place in His kingdom. It's also hard to hear because we are surrounded by and engaged in fighting and conflict everywhere. It consumes us. Everywhere we look, there are negative circumstances. We go to work, there are negative circumstances. We go to school, there are negative circumstances, and even at home. And not just physical, external circumstances are negative, but also internally. We have battles waging on inside of us. We have battles with addiction. We have battle wars of internal criticism that can be on the verge of crippling us. We battle wars of negativity and self-doubt. We've been crippled with internal fear that polarizes us. And like so many people I talk to, it leaves us tired, just so tired to fight the good fight anymore. Right? It leaves us too tired to do things like to deal with people's prejudice, to deal with people's ignorance, to deal with people's hate. It leaves us too tired to appease an abusive spouse or a partner or a coworker or a boss or bully to deal with a bully at school. It leaves us too tired to get up every day to face what is left from the struggle from the day before. Right? It leaves us too tired to face the failures and the mistakes from days gone by. Or too tired to face the fears that won't seem to go away. Or too tired to face the temptations that have beat us down so many times before, where we've lost and lost and wonder whether we'll ever be able to win. And so instead of thinking about something like resiliency, we just want to survive. Like, we just want to make it through today. Like, I don't know about this idea of resiliency, but if I could just make it through today and I could just survive and, you know, even in the morning, like if I could just get the day over with and go to bed and call it a day, that's kind of where we can live. And that doesn't seem like resiliency. But the problem is, friends, it, just like in life and in faith, we weren't meant to just survive. We were meant to do so much more than survive. We were meant to thrive and to flourish. And that's the gospel story, right? This idea of flourishing and thriving. Not just to survive and bounce back from these hardships and adversities, but to be formed into the image of Jesus Christ as a result of them. At least that's what Paul is trying to tell us in Romans 8:28. And the thing is, thriving is crucial, friends. The idea of thriving is crucial to our everyday functioning, because if not, we're going to get beat down and tired. This idea of thriving matters to who we are as a people. But the problem is, if we're being honest, is that our faith can be incredibly fragile. It's incredibly fragile. Sometimes we crumble under the weight of life, and we crumble under adversity and trials and hardships. So in order to navigate the fragility of our faith and life and to find a faith that is resilient, friends, we're going to have to come to terms with two facts that might be hard to hear. We're going to have to come to grips with a couple of things that are difficult to hear. The first is this: resiliency is not an individual trait that can be claimed and just had. Like, I can't just stand here and say, guess what, friends? Today you are all resilient. Like, I'm going to claim to be resilient. Resiliency is a process. You have to go through some stuff in order to have resiliency. That stuff is often hard and difficult, which leads me to the second thing. The process of building resiliency exists and is formed in adversity. Say it another way, the only way you're going to get resiliency is in diversity, not despite it. It's the only way. Adversity, trials, hardship is what builds resiliency. That's where it exists. That's where it's formed and it's shaped. And while we may want to run away from adversity and trials and hardships, it's in those very situations that have the most possible greatest effect on our resiliency. Those are the things that are going to shape us and form us the most. Not good times, but the hard times. In fact, like other areas of our lives, it's in our avoidance of adversity, it's in our avoidance of pain, it's in our avoidance of suffering, it's in our avoidance of trials that may be very well crippling us and leading to spiritual death. We've just protected ourselves from anything. We don't want to deal with it. We want to hide from it. We don't want to deal with it. And friends, one of the hardest parts about being a pastor, and it's not unique to us, every career and everything has its ups and its downs, but one of the hardest parts about being a pastor is coming up with the right words when people who are suffering and hurting are walking through difficult times. What do you say to someone who just lost their child? What do you say to someone that just lost their their loved one. Tomorrow's going to be better, right? No, it's hard to come up with the right things to say. And oftentimes we have to deal with that. But it's not all bad. There are oftentimes good things. And I want to share with you one of my favorite things is walking through premarital counseling with couples. I always give them homework, and that usually amounts to go interview a couple of couples that you look at their life and their faith, and you say, I want a faith like theirs. I want a marriage like theirs. And then you interview, I have them interview them and ask them, what did it take to get to a marriage that has gone the distance? Especially when you're interviewing couples that have been married 20, 30, 40, 50, 60 years. How did y'all do that? And while they give me lots of different answers, the longer a couple is married, the more likelihood they are to say that their marriage did not grow strong, and they didn't go the distance, not because everything was smooth and rosy and great and perfect, right? That it happened because they went through a lot of hard times and difficult times. That in fact, their marriage was only made strong and they were only able to go the distance because they went through hard times. And they came out stronger and better and closer together on the other end. And that's what faith is like. The trials and the hardships help us come out stronger on the other end. But the hardest part is getting to that point. You know, I could say that. I could say that it's, that's the thing. But the hard part is getting to a place where we accept that. That's hard. It's difficult. So this morning, I want to share with you probably the single most profound piece of advice I've ever received when it comes to this idea. When it comes to just to coming to a place where you can accept this. Right, the single most profound piece of advice. This comes from a counselor I saw during a very difficult season of ministry. I was dealing with burnout, and I was at my wit's end, and I was ready to blow my life up. I was tired. You ever been there? Right? I'm just tired. I don't want to deal with it anymore. I just want to quit. Like, I want to escape it. I'm done. Right? Enough. And I went to a counselor, and we walked through some of it. I was ready to blow my life up. And after I confessed all of that to my counselor, what he said was very simple but incredibly hard to hear. I didn't want to hear it. Here's what he said. He said, Scott, maybe you just need to sit in it. Maybe you just need to sit in it. And it took me a second. After the feelings of being irritated and frustrated and mad, like, that's all you got? Like, you're on the clock here, bud. You're going to tell me to sit in it? Right? No, I don't want to sit in it. Instead of, I want to escape my situation. I want to get away from it. I don't want to deal with it. I don't want to sit in it. I want to run away. I don't want to sit in it. I want to change my circumstances. I want to change my situation. I don't want to sit in it. But to sit in it, the longer I thought about it and the more we talked, to sit in it is to stay and be present in my situations. Right? Not to try to run away, not to try to escape it, but to be present. To feel all the feels that there were to feel, right? Sounds like a Dr. Seuss if it was written today, right? Feel all the feels. To think about my situation. And then to find out from there what there is to learn from it. And in doing so, you can begin to ask questions about what does this situation have to teach me? Right? What do I need to know? Who do I need to be? Right? What does it need to teach me about myself and who I am and what do I value and what do I fear and where do I turn to? What are my idols? Right? What does it teach me about myself? What does it teach me about my character? What fault do I have in my own situations? Right? It also teaches us sitting in it, teaches us about my views on God. Right? God, is God going to save me? Is he my Superman every time I get into trouble? Right? What is God like? What is difficulties and hardships, but to sit in it, to be present in our situations, to be present in our struggles, to be present in our hardships. And friends, sitting in our adversity and the feelings and the thoughts that we have in the midst of all of those, instead of escaping and medicating those issues, friends, that builds resilient faith, right? That builds resiliency. That builds resiliency that leads to a faith that perseveres and thrives. Because it's in those moments is where we experience Jesus. Sometimes when we realize that all we have is Jesus, that we can really realize how much we really have. And I to wrap up with something that those of you that know me, anybody that knows me well, I'm not a touchy-feely. I'm a very practical guy. I'm not into poetry, right? I'm very into very concrete ideas. And I want to share with you this morning a poem, and one poem in particular that has always helped me. So let me say it like this, okay? I do not like poetry. I do not read poetry. In all of my vast library, I have one poetry book by one poet and one poem in particular that I really like, right? And this is the poem. And the more I think about this, this poem is one about resiliency. And this is what it says. It says, did you hear about the rose that grew from a crack in the concrete? Proving nature's law is wrong, it learned to walk without having feet. Funny it seems, but by keeping its dreams, it learned to breathe fresh air. Long live the rose that grew from the concrete when no one else cared. It's an image of a rose, not a weed, right? Not grass, but a rose, something beautiful and special growing through a crack in a concrete. That's adversity, right? That is hardship, but something beautiful being formed and made through it. And here's the thing, some of you have no idea, have never heard this poem, and you probably never heard of the poet. It's written by a man by the name of Tupac Amaru Shakur, which if you don't know that, he is more known for his rap music. All my 80s and 90s and 2000 heads are fist pumping me and applauding me. But he was more known for his rap music than he was poetry, but he was a poet. And he was a man that knew a lot of hardship and adversity and struggle. But our faith can become like that rose that grows from the concrete, overcoming adversity. But we have to go through the struggle. We have to fight the good fight. Friends, as I wrap up, our hope here for you at Kingsway and for everyone is to find a resilient faith in light of adversity, not despite it. Because we can't. Right? Life is full of hardships and difficulties. Even those that we look at and think, well, they've never had to deal with anything different. Not true. It is a common problem. We all deal with it. No matter what age and generation you find yourself in, we want to help you build resiliency in our discipleship and in our programming and just in life and faith and mentoring and all of those things. We hope and work for this in our children's ministry at such a young age. And we're trying to make resources available for our youngest people through things like our Bible study class and other things to help them understand and navigate faith and trials as children. We work towards this in our youth ministry through small groups and mission trips and life-on-life conversations and relationships and helping kids talk about that it's okay to not be okay. It's okay to deal with these things and to have people to listen to and share advice and to be there for them when they fall and to be there for them when life gets tough. Right, we hope this for our college-age people like Caitlin as she pursues her call to be a doctor, or Wesley Spargo and Kelsey Mitchell as they pursue pastoral ministry, right? To find their place and to become resilient disciples. We hope this for you as adults and for our senior adults and all the way through our whole shared life together and our experience to figure out how to be resilient disciples, just like Daniel and Caitlin shared in their video this week with us. Resilient disciples, like a rose that grows through the concrete. That's our hope. That's our faith for you. Will you pray with me? God, thank you for life and for faith and for experiences and the way in which we grow and know and experience you. God, help us to be like a rose that grows through the concrete. Help us to thrive in the midst of adversity and trials and growing closer to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Friends, today
we get to experience communion. It's a time where we come to the table in communion. And the thing about communion, it's a time and it's a place for grace. It's a sacred moment where we get to meet with God, where God reaches down and touches us in our successes and in our trials. And no matter where you what you're going through right now or what may lay ahead, our hope and our prayer is that you experience God's love and grace when you come to the table. Even as Reverend Lynn Dyke shared a few weeks ago, even if that means you have to come hobbling to it, right? You have to hobble to the table. As we prepare for communion, I'll just share a few things with you that are important to know. At Kingsway, we celebrate open communion, which means whether this is your first time or your 100th time, whether you're a member of Kingsway or not, whether you're Methodist or not, it is open to all are welcome. You don't have to have an ID to prove anything. You just have to come with a heart to connect with God. All of our elements, the juice and the bread today, are gluten-free, so you don't have to worry about gluten allergies. In just a few moments, our ushers will come forward and we'll dismiss you row by row. You can come up or you can stay in your seat. You don't have to come up. If you need assistance, just let an usher know. And as you come up, you will receive bread and a cup of juice to take as you see fit. And after you've received it, feel free. You can come and pray at the altar. The altar is open. Or you can return to your seat around either side where you will find receptacles to drop your cup and dispose of your cup as you need it. Now, at just the right time, Jesus came and he dwelt among us. He dwelt as one of us, bringing good news to the poor. He healed the sick. He raised the dead, and he shared a table with the unrighteous. And he taught them the way that leads to life. By his incarnation, his life, his own suffering, his execution and resurrection, he gave birth to the church, delivered us from slavery, and made a new covenant with us by water and the Spirit. When he ascended, knowing that what would lie ahead of us, he promised to be with us always in the power of his word and in the power of the Spirit. And on the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took the bread and he blessed it and he broke it and he gave it to his disciples and said, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." He did the same thing with the cup after supper. He took thanks, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Drink from this, all of you. This is the blood of the new covenant poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." So God, in remembrance of all you have done to save us, we offer ourselves to you in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of the faith, that Christ has come among us, Christ has died, Christ has risen, Christ abides in us, and Christ will come again. So God, pour out your Spirit on us and pour out your Spirit on these gifts of bread and juice and make these gifts the body and blood of Christ for us. Make us through them one with one another and Christ's body alive in the world. And by your Spirit, make us one with Christ and one with each other in service to the world until you come again and we see you face to face. And now with the confidence of loving children, let us pray the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples to pray so long ago. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Friends, as our ushers or as our servers come forward to help, we will serve them first. The ushers will then come forward to serve you, or to dismiss you to come up and receive. Friends, as ushers come forward, the table has been set. Come and receive.
My enemies, fill all my fears.
Friends, in just a moment, you're going to see some images on the screens of our time in Summer Jam of making waves and having fun. So I'd encourage you, maybe just linger for a moment, watch a few videos, see some smiles, see some people you know doing some crazy things to show love to kids, to share the good news, and to help make disciples of the nations. I encourage you, as you go out this week, I hope that as you go on the highways and byways of life, as trials come, as good things come, right, that you fall hopelessly in love with Jesus and find resilient faith like the rose that grew through the concrete. But as you go, I pray that you go in grace and peace as a beloved child of God. Amen.